Excellencies, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. It is with profound honor and pleasure that I join you today together with the Gambian delegation representing the First Lady of the Republic of the Gambia, Her Excellency Madam Zainab Yahya Jammeh, on this auspicious occasion to give a few remarks on the way forward, but focusing on women empowerment and education and the participation of the private sector and CSOs, civil society organizations in the Gambia. I would like to seize this opportunity to extend my heartfelt gratitude and appreciation to the Peace Island Institute, the Journalists and Writers Foundation, the West African Development Society, as well as the African Empowerment Council for organizing such a significant and important event and for inviting us to participate. Allow me also to convey greetings to you all from the President of the Republic of the Gambia, His Excellency Sir Professor Alhaji Dr. Yahya AJJ Jammeh Babili Mansa, and Her Excellency the First Lady of the Republic of the Gambia, Madam Zainab Yahya Jammeh, who due to unavoidable circumstances is unable to be here with us physically. But I can assure you that she's here in spirit and wishes us all a successful deliberation. Ladies and gentlemen, the issue of women empowerment is an intractable matter that requires the collaborative and persistent efforts of all members of society, including the private sector and civil society organizations, to advance the cause of poverty reduction, food security, good health, and quality education for all, especially for women and children who are the most vulnerable in our society. As part of the relentless efforts of a concerted partnership which includes civil society organizations, public and private sectors, coupled with the international community to reduce poverty and improve the lives of the population, the Gambia has made significant strides in the social and productive sectors of the economy. The country's remarkable advancement and achievements towards attaining food self-sufficiency is not only manifested through the hard work and dedication of Gambian women in providing for their families as inspired by the leader of the nation, but has also been recognized by the United Nations Food and Agricultural Organization, FAO, with a presentation of a prestigious award to His Excellency the President of the Republic. This award, which is dedicated to the women of the Gambia, further provides glaring appreciation of His Excellency's personal interests and efforts in agriculture, culminating in the nation's impressive results in meeting the MDG 1C target of reducing hunger and malnutrition by half. Moderator, distinguished guests, Gambian women constitute about 70% of the agricultural labor force, but their production is often only limited to subsistence farming. Women are the main producers of rice and other food types in the country. Hence, efforts to increase women's participation in large-scale commercial agriculture are indeed a laudable policy direction towards achieving the vision, the country's vision 2016 on food self-sufficiency development agenda and beyond. Through meaningful partnerships of both public and private sectors, women are also actively engaged in the area of livestock, pastoral farming, mixed farming systems, and horticultural production. In the area of fisheries, women are more commonly occupied in subsistence and commercial fishing, using small boats and canoes in coastal or inland waters. The income earned by women from such activities is often spent on household matters, such as the education of their children and the fulfillment of other social obligations. The government's health sector is another beneficiary of partnerships aimed at addressing the risk posed by deadly diseases like HIV/AIDS, as well as cervical and breast cancer on women and children. with the introduction of programs like the elimination of mother-to-child transmission of HIV to curb the level of new HIV infections amongst newborn babies and the HPV vaccine for schoolgirls as priorities. Similarly, collaborative efforts using this partnership platform are indeed yielding benefits, particularly in curbing health complications derived from cultural practices, such as early child marriage. Early marriage does not only have health implications, but have negative effects on the education of the girl child, thereby restricting her potential for a professional career. In the Gambia, the fundamental right of women to have access to education has been recognized by His Excellency the President as a human rights issue, based on the firm belief that education for girls is an effective means of achieving the goals and objectives of other sectoral policies and programs within government. It is for this reason that government focuses on providing accessible and affordable quality education to all, on one hand, and reducing the rate of illiteracy among the adult female population on the other. Without doubt, the Second Republic witnessed unprecedented levels of achievements in the education sector over and above the First Republic before 1994. Evidence of these achievements resides in the fact that enrollment rates for girls in the First Republic only stood at 47% in lower basic, 7% at the upper basic, that is what we call the middle schools, and 2% at the senior secondary levels. In sharp contrast, the Second Republic has cause to celebrate the following increases from 47% to 101% for lower basic, that's primary level education, from 7% to 68% in upper basic, and 2% to 42% in senior secondary education. Today, out of the total number of students in the basic and secondary education levels of the Gambian education system, which is at 434,904, 221,550 are girls. These achievements would not have been registered without the strong political will of government driven by His Excellency the President's passion and unwavering commitment in the overall welfare of women in the Gambia. I would also like to add that in order to ensure that women and children in the Gambia get quality health care, Her Excellency the First Lady of the Republic of the Gambia personally launched Operation Save the Children Foundation on the 21st of November 2014 with the objective of protecting children from all forms of abuse and exploitation, preventing malnutrition amongst children, and ensuring that all children have the full parental care they deserve, including orphans and differently abled children, amongst others. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, as we enter the dawn of the post-2015 era with the Sustainable Development Goals as targets for 2030, the government of the Gambia, like other countries, in keeping with Goal 17 of the SDGs, will continue to mobilize the participation of the private sector, civil society organizations, and other development partners through a strong partnership in order to help create new resources to finance and to finance the implementation of these goals. This is predicated on the belief that no one segment of society has what it takes to exclusively achieve the Sustainable Development Goals. And therefore, the only path to success is working in unison, bearing in mind that our efforts today can transform into sustainable economic growth for present and future Gambia to benefit from, and I'm sure the same thing would apply for other countries such as the Gambia. To conclude, I would like to state that all these achievements, as well as activities that we wish to implement over the next 15 years, cannot happen in the absence of peace and stability in our countries. And as such, the Gambia government, under the leadership of His Excellency the President, places a high premium on the maintenance of peace and stability and adopts zero tolerance of anything that jeopardizes the peace and stability in our country. Furthermore, to attain the sustainable development goals requires resources. Many countries have started before now to build on the MDGs and to consolidate the gains made in a number of the goals that we are talking about. However, we need to bear in mind that achieving the sustainable development goals requires the mobilization of resources, both domestically and from partners. So far, a lot of pledges have been made to support countries in the implementation of the SDGs. I'm just from a conference about 3-4 days ago, which was to do with the launching of the global strategy for women, children, and adolescents' health. And as we sat there, a lot of pledges were made. And I would like to call on partners to make those pledges good. The greatest challenge for developing and least developed countries in the implementation of the MDGs was access to adequate resources. The uncertainty of accessing resources left a lot of countries behind in attaining health, education, agriculture, and other targets that were set. I remember that in 2000, when the Dakar Framework for Action came into being, the pledge from the international community was that no country with a 10-year strategic plan that was costed will be delayed in implementation due to lack of resources. And we know that even though a lot of progress has been made, a lot more couldn't be done by a lot of countries due to the lack of access to adequate resources. I therefore call on all concerned to help move Agenda 2030 faster than Agenda 2015. I thank you all for your kind attention.